Good morning. It's wonderful to see you today as we gather for public worship together. You're all very welcome indeed, particularly if you happen to be visiting here. Give you a warm welcome this morning. A couple of announcements as we begin this morning. As you may hopefully already know, there will be an annual general meeting of the congregation after the service today. There'll be a brief interlude in between, so if you don't intend to stay for the meeting, there'll be opportunity to leave. There'll also be tea and coffee available at that stage, or indeed after the meeting. Hope you'll be able to stay for that. Should mention that along with the stated business of the meeting, there will be a couple of things presented to individuals by way of thank you, so it may well be that you don't wish to miss that. Next Saturday is a very special day, our Platinum Pudding Party. Very much looking forward to it. Trust that you are also. And there's plenty of detail there, not least about the various ways in which we can all help out. And on that vein, want to thank all who helped out yesterday at the Cars and Coffee morning. It was really wonderful time. Some very impressive vehicles and a real good sense of community together, which was just lovely. Kirk Session, God willing, will meet on Wednesday week. That's the 8th of June at 8 p.m. I think, if I'm not mistaken, that those are all the things I am to announce formally this morning, but the other announcements, of course, all important too. John's Gospel, its author tells us, was written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and that believing, you may have life in his name. We'll join in prayer together. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you are the one who gives life, that you are the one who enables new life. Grant that we may encounter you today and so glorify your name for your holy sake. Amen. We'll keep our seats and sing together, Jesus, we enthrone you. We'll join again in prayer together. Let's pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you are exalted above the heavens. Before you every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that you are Lord, to the glory of God the Father. We are gathered that you may build a throne in our presence, that we may honour your name in this time together, and that we may be equipped and inspired to honour your name in all that lies between now and when we next gather for public worship. You, Lord God, are breathtaking in the wonder of your character, unsearchable in the majesty of your ways. You know all things and nothing is hidden from you. Everything is naked and laid bare before the eyes of Him to whom we all will give account. You, Lord God, are likewise abundant in mercy and grace. You forgive trespasses and iniquities and sins. You willingly show forgiveness to all who come sincerely to You. That forgiveness, Lord God, we have much need of. And we much need not only of Your grace to forgive, but likewise of Your grace to transform the heart, to renew our attitudes, to give us a different outlook, to change our perspective. Lord Jesus, come and minister to us that we may be made new in Your likeness, that we may have new life in Your name, that we may be enabled in all things to glorify and enjoy You. So, Lord Jesus, we continue our prayer in Your own words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We'll stand and sing together, King of the Ages. We continue this morning with the book of Colossians, reading today what remains of chapter 2, picking up at verse 6 and reading through to verse 23, and Stephen Cowden will read for us.
Colossians 2, Colossians chapter 2, verses 6 to 23. Since you've accepted Jesus Christ as Lord, live in union with him. Keep your roots deep in him, build your lives in him, and become stronger in your faith as you were taught, and be filled with thanksgiving. See to it, then, that no one enslaves you by means of worthless deceit of human wisdom, which comes from the teachings handed down by human beings and from the ruling spirits of the universe, and not from Christ. For the full content of divine nature lives in Christ, in his humanity, and you will have been given full life in union with him. He is supreme over every spiritual ruler and authority. In union with Christ you were circumcised, not by the circumcision that is made by human beings, but with the circumcision made by Christ, which consists of being freed from the power of this sinful self. For when you were baptized, you were buried with Christ, and in baptism you were also raised with Christ through your faith in the active power of God, who raised him from death. You were at one time spiritually dead because of your sins and because you were Gentiles without the law. But God has now brought you to life with Christ. God forgave us all our sins. He cancelled the unfavourable records of our debts with its binding rules and did away with it completely by nailing it to the cross. And on that cross, Christ freed himself from the power of the spiritual rulers and authorities. He made a public spectacle of them by leading them as captives in his victory procession. So let no one make rules about what you are to eat or drink, or about holy days, or the new moon festival, or the Sabbath. All such things are only a shadow of things in the future. The reality is Christ. Do not allow yourselves to be condemned by anyone who claims to be superior because of special visions and who insists on false humility and the worship of angels. For no such reason at all, such people are all puffed up by the human way of thinking and have stopped holding on to Christ, who is the head of the body. Under Christ's control, the whole body is nourished and held together by its joints and ligaments, and it grows as God wants it to grow. You have died with Christ and are set free from the ruling spirits of the universe. Why then do you live as though you belong to this world? Why do you obey such rules as don't handle this, don't taste that, don't touch the other? All these refer to things which become useless once they are used. They are only human rules and teachings. Of course, such rules appear to be based on wisdom in their forced worship of angels and false humility and serve treatment of the body, but they have no real value in controlling physical passions. Amen.
Thank you, Stephen. Girls and boys, come into the front. A few more on our way down. This is great. I'd like to slide over this way a little bit, and then the people who are coming that way can get a little closer to the centre too. If you don't, oh, nudge over to your left a little maybe. That's the job. That's just brilliant. It's great to see you all. Now, not for the first time, and I would imagine probably not for the last, I'm going to do something a little bit silly. And I need a volunteer, but it struck me through the week that the kind of thing I'm going to ask for a volunteer for, I should probably ask their mum and dad beforehand. So I've already got my volunteer arranged, but I do appreciate the willingness that people would offer with. So If it's not you today, maybe it will be you some other time. And if you do want to volunteer for something, I'd be very glad to hear from you. So Jemima's going to come up and help me. And what we're going to do is we're going to go for a walk. We're going to disappear out of your sight altogether to see if we can find something that is hopefully where I hid it earlier. If it's not, we're in real trouble. And it'll be good for everybody if we do manage to find it, I'll tell you that much. And perhaps Darren will kindly leave my microphone on and you might be able to hear if we're making any progress or not. So sit where you are, listen out, and you can even hope and pray, if you like, that we'll return safely with what we're meant to find. Are you going to come with me, Jemima? Good girl. Good girl. You go on ahead, yeah. We shouldn't be too long, hopefully. Now, who are you going to take my hand? What a rubbish. We'll go up the stairs, I think, yeah. We'll see if we can get up these stairs. And I hope we might... Yeah, they're big stairs, aren't they? But you can do it very well, can't you? Oh, that's brilliant. Now, if we go this way... We might well see everybody up here, yeah. But what's this here? Chocolate. It wouldn't be chocolate, would it? I think it might be. Do you want to say hello to everybody from up here before you go down? They can all see you. Hello. I'm not sure if they're waving at us or at the chocolate, Jemima, but they're waving anyway. Come on, we'll go on this way. Ooh, good girl. And we'll go up here. And we'll make sure none of these people steal our chocolates on the way past. And then we'll see if we can get down these stairs carefully as well as we got up the other ones. You'll need to keep me right.
The red one?
Oh, yes, yeah. Good girl, are you okay there?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You can see everybody downstairs now, that's right, yeah.
Yeah. My mum.
That's right, and we'll get back up to where the boys and girls are at the front.
Oh.
Now, thank you very much, Jemima, and thank you all for sitting so well. If you want to sit down again a wee second, I'll explain to you very quickly why I thought of doing that. You could send somebody out on a journey, wouldn't you? I could have said to somebody, go and have a dander around the church. But I didn't do that. I got somebody to go and I went with them. And it's a wee bit like that with Jesus. Oh, are you okay? Jesus doesn't send us off to go ourselves. Jesus promises to go with us. And in the Bible reading that we've just heard, and in many others, talks about a journey as we grow in our faith, and Jesus goes with us all the way, and that is a wonderful thing to know. So you remember us walking around the church, and you get your bar of chocolate on the way out. Remember that Jesus is willing to walk with you as you trust and follow him.
I'm with that one.
I think we'll pray before we go any further. We'll close our eyes and we'll pray together. Lord Jesus, thank you that you're willing to walk with us, that you call us out on a journey of faith as we follow you and walk hand in hand with you. Help us to trust and walk with you all our days for your sake. Amen. Well, we're going to stand up and sing, and words that really reflect what we've just been talking about. It's an adventure following Jesus as we walk with him. So we'll all stand and sing together. And you might get one of these on your way out. It's a big decision which chocolate bar you should take. I think my son nearly stopped to pray for guidance for a moment. Well, we shall join together in prayer, and Roberta will lead us.
Let us pray. Jesus, you said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." Father, we claim your peace for our hearts that are breaking. We bring before you the families and friends of the children and teachers murdered in Texas. We know your heart also breaks for them. Please use your church to draw your loving and comforting arms around them as they grieve. Lord, give your peace to those who are living in the turmoil and upheaval of war, those suffering oppression and living in poverty. We bring especially those in the Ukraine, Afghanistan, Yemen and Ethiopia. Thank you for the aid agencies such as Christian Aid, Hope 360 and many others who are working tirelessly to bring comfort and the basic essentials for life, things that we take for granted. Abundantly bless those workers. May they be encouraged and strengthened by our prayers and practical support, and may they know your peace. Father, we ask that you would surround those who are dealing with illness, either mental or physical, those waiting anxiously for test results or the commencement of treatment. Lord, put your circle of peace around them. As they face uncertain futures, may they know your presence. and help them to rest in your love and trust in your goodness. We also pray for their families who feel so helpless as they watch their loved ones struggle. May they too find comfort and strength in you. Father, bring peace to our young people who are anxious and fearful in this exam season. May they gain your perspective, and may they rest in the knowledge that your plan and purpose for their lives does not depend on exam results. Help parents and teachers to find the right words to say so that young people receive a balance of encouragement and support. Father, your peace comes from knowing you. We pray that as a congregation, we would take every opportunity to reach those who do not yet know you. Mm-hmm. We pray for our outreach this Jubilee weekend. Lord, may the strangers who come through our gates find a welcome, acceptance and love. Give us opportunities for meaningful conversations that allows us to share the good news. Father, we give thanks for growing community and cooperation between the churches in the town and the net. May that continue to grow and develop as we all seek to serve and promote your kingdom. Father, we pray for our leaders and those in authority in our nation. Lord, grant them wisdom and moral integrity as they tackle the problems facing the health service, education, security and economy. May they have the political will to work together for the peace and stability of our country. Father, we give thanks for our social services and agencies such as the Food Bank, Women's Aid and Sure Start that are all a lifeline for people who are struggling. As the country faces a time of recession, rising fuel and food costs, Lord, give us the spiritual gift of generosity, remembering that we are blessed to be a blessing. Father, as we bring these prayers before you, we give thanks again for your word that reassures us that we don't need to be troubled or fearful because you have promised your peace when we place our trust in you. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Roberta. We'll stand and sing together, Jesus Shall Take the Highest Honour. What do you expect from a baby? There's a new baby in your own home or the home of a loved one or a relation or simply in the wider community. What do you expect from them? Well, often when people anticipate a baby arriving soon, there are lots of jokes, aren't there, to the effect that the parents should expect sleepless nights and dirty nappies and a whole lot less money to spend on things that they spent it on previously. And of course, there's a certain degree of truth in that. There are also often, thank God, really strong expectations of days filled with love and that warm sense that comes from holding a very young child and all that's just inexplicably special about that. But if you'll allow me, not for the first time, to be a little silly, what might you expect a child to do? Well, it does sound like a ludicrous question, doesn't it? But you don't expect them to go out and cut the grass or tidy their bedroom or help make the dinner. If you can get them to do that 15 years down the line, you'll be doing very well. Never mind in their earliest days. You don't expect them to do anything. But actually, you do expect them to grow, don't you? You maybe don't ever voice that expectation, and perhaps it's only if you have some suspicion that the growth isn't happening in the way that you would desire it to that you ever begin to think about it. But even without stating it, you expect that they're going to grow, that a month or 2 months or three or four down the line, they'll not be exactly as they were before. They'll be a bit bigger, able to do things that maybe they couldn't do. And it doesn't happen so instantly that you can observe it, but it happens in a way that is undeniable and clear nonetheless. And it's very much what you expect and long for and desire. That, I suppose, rather obvious fact sheds a lot of light on Jesus' statement about being born again, doesn't it? It's one of the most familiar and perhaps at times most misquoted statements in the Bible, where Jesus says you must be born again, you need the Holy Spirit to work a new birth in you and give you a new start before God. But when he doesn't spell it out there and then, that obviously implies, does it not, that Christian people are expected to grow. As a newborn baby grows and develops physically, so somebody that's born again by the Spirit of God, with the passage of time and the giving of his grace, they grow up in their faith. They mature. They become more truly what Christ wants them to be. They become more like Jesus himself. It's part and parcel of Christian living. It's central to the gospel that when we know the Lord, when we belong to him, it's his desire and intention and purpose that we should grow. That's something that's clear in the portion of Colossians chapter 2 that we read together earlier. It's really clear, in fact, in the first two verses. Just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. Paul had a remarkable gift, did he not, for stating a great many things in a small number of words. And here you have a lot of ideas coming together in but a brief sentence or two. They've received Christ as Lord. They're committed Christians. He's bore testimony to that earlier in the letter. He's given thanks for their faith, which in many ways is so admirable. And it's his prayer and his desire and his instruction to them indeed that having received Christ, they might go on living in him and for him, being both rooted and built up in him. Interesting how he mixes his metaphors there. On the one hand, it's organic, rooted, the illustration from the natural world. And then on the other, it's built up, a kind of man-made illustration. And the two together give a fuller picture. They're rooted in Christ and they're built up in him by his grace and with their own good endeavours by his power. They grow in spiritual maturity. They grow in such maturity according to the teaching of his word. They're strengthened in the faith, as you were taught. And as they grow, what proves to be more and more characteristic of them is their thankfulness. It simply overflows. It's expressed surely in song as they gather together to meet for worship. It's expressed doubtless in prayer. It's expressed surely in the words that they speak to one another and to other people generally. It's expressed moreover in the way that they live. What characterizes them is their gratitude to Jesus. Jesus who has taken hold of them. Jesus who's granted them new birth. Jesus who's growing his life in them as they grow to be more and more like him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith, overflowing in thankfulness. But for all that, maybe the most significant word in those opening two verses is the word Lord. Paul could have put almost any number of words in that place, in that sentence, and it would have made sense. He could have said, as you received Christ Jesus as Saviour, as you received Christ Jesus as friend, as you received Christ Jesus as your comforter. Oh, there are plenty of words that would fit in there and make perfect grammatical and theological sense. But the word that Paul chooses is Lord. Just as you accepted Christ as your master, just as you placed him on the driving seat in your life, just as you determined that he would be the one who would call the shots, that you would march to his drumbeat, that he would be your commanding officer. Well, keep going on that pathway. Just as you received him as Lord, continue to live under his lordship, and thus being rooted and built up, strengthened and overflowing in thankfulness. It would be easy to suppose that that is Paul laying down the law, that is Paul saying, here's a whole lot of rules, and boy, had you better stick to them. And at times, it's been tempting through the ages and down to the present day for individual Christians or for the church as a whole to kind of reduce the whole thing to a list of do's and don'ts and things that we really won't ever do and things that we really ought to do, and it becomes a kind of box-ticking exercise where all these rules, positive or negative, have to be kept. And a call to growth and maturity, a call to live under the lordship of Christ, could be misunderstood in that kind of way. That's why Paul devotes a considerable chunk of this chapter to warning people against that very mindset. It's indicated, first of all, in verse 8, don't let anyone take you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends ultimately on mere human beings rather than on Christ. And then he spells it out in more detail from verse 16 onwards. Don't let people judge you by their particular rules about what you can eat or drink or what you can do on any given day. Now these are a shadow of the things to come. The reality is found in Christ. Or verse 20, since you died with Christ to the elemental spiritual forces of this world, why, as though you still belong to the world, do you submit to its rules? Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. These rules have to do with things that are all destined to perish with use. They're based on mere human commands and teachings. They look the part. They give the impression that somebody's very sincere and devout, but they lack any value in restraining sensual indulgence. They don't get you any closer to God. They don't bring about any growth in your character. They underestimate and misinterpret what the whole thing is about. Paul makes a clear call to the Colossian Christians to live under the lordship of Christ. He makes an equally clear statement that that is not about reducing the faith to a list of do's and don'ts. Well, there you have the beginning and the end of this particular chunk of Colossians chapter 2. At the beginning, a call to mature Christian living, to growing in grace. At the end, a clear indication that that does not mean a whole list of do's and don'ts. What do you get in between? Well, I hope what you get in between won't come as a surprise to you, because it's Paul's favourite subject and it's his favourite approach to every pastoral matter. What you get in between is a wonderful statement about the greatness of Christ. What will incline the Colossian Christians to go on and grow on in their Christian journey? Well, seeing anew and afresh and with deeper eyes who Jesus is and what he has done. And what will keep them from getting into a legalistic mindset of rule keeping? Seeing who Jesus is and what he's done. And so Paul devotes the central part of this passage to that very subject. He reminds them that in Christ all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form, that Christ is the one who, when they were dead in trespasses and sin, has made them alive, who's taken away the charge that stood against them and nailed it to the cross. Christ, God in human flesh, has come to their rescue. The Lord of glory has made atonement for them. He's brought them to new life, and he it is who enables them to grow in that new life. Christ enables new life. Whatever you do, do not imagine that Christianity is a list of do's and don'ts. That mindset is all around, is it not? It's been common in Northern Ireland for as long as Northern Ireland has been a country in its own right. There was a day and age when not going to the cinema was proof that you took your faith seriously, or at least that was the way that people seemed to see it. And there's that phrase that you may have encountered, that I've encountered regularly, that I heard used, in fact, only yesterday. Somebody is good living. They're committed to the rules. And the thing that always fascinates me about the phrase is that it's announced with such a sense of profound gloom. They're good living. What a disaster. People see it as something terrible. Why? Well, because the whole picture of Christianity is that Christians are these people who live by these rules that they don't even really want to live by, but they're afraid that if they don't, they'll be damned. And it's all seen as a miserable, rule-keeping thing. And the devil, of course, has his hand in deluding people thus. Well, Paul is absolutely emphatic about it, isn't he? It's not about do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. It's not about a whole list of rules that are always to be kept. It's about a living relationship with the Lord of glory, having received him as Lord, living your life in him, being built up in him, knowing him, drawing closer to him. Oh, don't ever please see Christianity as a set of rules. It has its moral standards for sure, but it's no mere ethical code. It's no more system of legalistic rule keeping. It's all about a person who is the Son of God, God in human flesh, and who invites all people to have life in himself. Then there is surely a challenging call here, isn't there, to deliberately, consciously, willingly live under the lordship of Christ. To accept his authority, to trust that he is the one to whom we ought to submit in everything. It is Jesus Christ's constant and unashamed assistance that he has more right to run my life than I do, and that he will make a better job of it than I would. Boy, does that ever cut across your pride. It's a humbling, embarrassing thing in a sense. It's something that the old nature naturally rebels against. We don't want to submit to his authority. We don't want to let him determine how we should use our time or how we should respond to certain people in certain situations. We'd much rather make our own mind up. Yet the wondrous thing is that those who submit to him, those who walk in his way, those who gladly accept his lordship, find a freedom there that nobody else can give. The one who will only let us have him if we have him as Lord and not on any lesser term, he is the one who sets people free and who gives people life. The sun sets you free, you'll be free indeed. Live under the lordship of Christ. Well, how, you might ask, or what does it mean? How do you do that? How do you go about this on a day and daily basis? In a sense, it all whittles down to simply asking on a continual basis for the Lord's help. When you sit down to read your Bible, when you've a quiet moment before you come out to church, when you're going to pray, when you're going to walk into the classroom as student or teacher, when you're going to sit behind the steering wheel, when you're going to do whatever you do, take but a moment to ask that the Holy Spirit may help you, that God's presence may be apparent to you, that you may be aware of him, that you may be enabled to honour him, that even in that moment you might be strengthened in the faith as you were taught, rooted and built up in him, overflowing with thankfulness, living under his lordship, and thus growing to his glory. What is it that might motivate Christian people to live thus? Well, it's simply Christ and who he is and what he has accomplished. That one who is the fullness of the divinity in human nature, one in whom the fullness of God lives in bodily form, that he should give his life for us on the cross, that should be the wisdom of God demonstrated for our salvation. Isn't that a full and comprehensive proof that he loves us? Isn't it a full and comprehensive proof that he can be trusted? That even when what he asks us to do is demanding and uncomfortable, even when the path he leads us down is challenging, that he knows what he's doing, that his character is dependable. Christ enables new life. Let's all look to him. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we rejoice that you do indeed enable new life. Keep us, Lord, from ever eroding Christianity into a mere set of rules. Help us see how it's all about a personal relationship with you. Give us at the same time, Lord, a clear awareness of the fact that you call us to submit to your lordship, and enable us, please, to willingly do that. Thank you that you're ever willing to offer us your help. Grant that day and daily, moment by moment, we may rely on your Spirit and so be enabled to live to your glory. Lord Jesus, give us such a sense of who you are, an overwhelming awareness of your greatness and your glory, that we're thus inclined with all our hearts to live for you, to grow in you, and to praise you. It is for your sake that we ask it. Amen. My heart is filled with thankfulness. Every day we live on earth is given by the King. Let's give our lives, our all, to love and follow him. We'll stand and sing together. Lord Jesus, you by your Spirit enable new life. Grant to us then that grace that we may trust you, grow in you, and live to your glory. And so may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. Amen.